Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, I have a book that will keep you guessing, and I won't give you the answer even at the end. You'll have to read it for yourself, but you will be surprised. My guest is Robert Rothstein, who has written Reckless Disregard. It is a Parker Stern novel, which means it's the second in his list. And it is published by Seventh Street Books. Welcome, Robert.
Connie, thank you very much for having me.
Well, it's my pleasure. I couldn't put the book down because I couldn't figure it out.
Well, that's the point. There are a lot of twists and turns, and hopefully all readers will keep reading.
All right. Now, Parker Stern, who is your hero, was he the same type of character in the first book?
Yes, Parker Stern is was a up-and-coming lawyer, a hotshot, a superstar under 40. And then in the first book, which is called Corrupt Practices, he had a traumatic experience. His mentor died violently. And ever since then, Parker has suffered from a severe case of stage fright every time he walks into a courtroom, so debilitating that sometimes he even passes out. In book one, he's called upon to defend an ex-partner against a nefarious church. In Reckless Disregard, Parker, still suffering stage fright, tries to slow down. He's mediating cases, not trying them, but then someone hacks his computer, a mysterious video game designer named Ponyard, who wants Parker to take his case.
And he doesn't want to. And Ponyard says, "I know, in essence, something about you that you don't want the rest of the world to know."
That's right. Parker has some deep, dark secrets that come out in book one. He doesn't want people to know. And Ponyard somehow has, against all odds, figured it out. So Parker takes the case. But there's another reason Parker takes the case, and that's a personal reason. He, in book one, had a relationship with one of his ex-law students, a brilliant woman.
And, Felicity?
her name is believe it or not, Lovely Diamond. As Parker says, it's her real name. He's checked her driver's license. And Lovely Diamond is a brilliant, though damaged, lawyer. And in book two, something happens to their relationship, and Parker wants to find out, and he realizes that by taking Ponyard's case, he can find out what happened with him and Lovely.
Now, Lovely, in her earlier years, had been both in porn and strippers, and she's the first to tell you. And she has a young son or boy living at her home with her father, who's quite a character.
Yes, Lovely has a very checkered past. She had a father who was both a certified public accountant for the studios and a porn director, but he directed artistic porn, and he was very proud of his artistic ability. And Lovely went through about a year of rebellion and performed in porn herself. Parker had a lot of problems with it in book one, but dealt with it. But what Lovely and Parker have in common is that they both love to try cases and they both want to get to the truth. And that's what both my books are about, the drive of a lawyer to get to the truth.
And to win.
And to win,
right.
Yes.
Well, the case that they're both now involved in would be if you put, let's see, Murdoch against maybe Sterling, that have been accused, but our friend Ponyard has put them into a cartoon. And the cartoon teaches one as, Bridges the man is... he's a pirate who will do anything. And the other party is Ponyard himself and obviously the good man. So now Mr. Bridges, who's head of a studio, wants to clear his name and get that son of a gun.
Right. Yeah. Ponyard is this mysterious video game designer. What's always been interesting to me is that the internet really creates the ability for people to be anonymous. It's frightening. We see it in scary situations in real life. So reckless disregard explores that. Ponyard does not want anyone to know who he is, and that includes Parker. He'll only communicate with his own lawyer, Parker, through email and texting. And Ponyard designs a video game that adults and kids play called Abduction. And in Abduction, Ponyard accuses this movie mogul, kind of a conglomeration. I've been an entertainment lawyer, and I've always been interested, going back to Louis B. Mayer and Lou Wasserman and others. So William Bishop is a movie mogul, and Ponyard in the video game Abduction accuses him of abducting and maybe murdering an actress named Felicity McGrath in the 1980s. And of course, William Bishop, who is nicknamed the Conqueror, much to his chagrin, brings a libel suit against Ponyard, and Parker is called upon to defend the libel suit. And the best defense to a libel suit is that the statements are true. So Parker's faced with trying to prove that Bishop, in fact, did kidnap Felicity McGrath. Not an easy thing, especially when Parker's own client won't come clean about who he is.
And even in IMDb, which is where anybody who wants to know the history of someone in show business, they don't have a listing for that movie that Bishop was in. And even the fact that Bishop's father was the one who said, pull the plug, we're not having anything more to do with it, but there was a movie.
Right. Parker learns early on, he's got a very intrepid, although naive assistant named Brenda. And Brenda discovers that in searching the Internet Movie Database that William Bishop was actually an actor. But what's interesting is it's not the current Internet Movie Database. It's a database that existed at the outset of the Internet. Very interesting to me because in my practice, the Internet started in about the 90s, and I do copyright law, and there were very interesting copyright issues. So I remember this very old database that was just something that people would contribute to. It wasn't commercial, it wasn't owned, it wasn't widespread, it wasn't very interesting in graphics, it was just text, and there were some very interesting information there. And I thought, what if there's this little fragment left over from those old time, if you will, internet databases that used the Linux system but no longer exists. So Parker finds out that, and Brenda, his assistant, find out that William the Conqueror Bishop actually supposedly acted in the movie in the 70s, and all trace of that acting role seemed to be gone except in that one little fragment that Brenda found. So Parker's got to track that down. Again, the internet is wonderful for creating mystery, I think.
So they do go to court, and his old girlfriend, Loverly, is on the other side of the chair. And as they go in, the judge, who seems to be favoring both sides, I must say he seemed equal, said, okay, we'll let you do this where Ponyard doesn't have to come to court. And he's been debriefed outside of the court. Now what happens is the judge says he excuses himself because he had been in a case with Parker. Now comes out the news, our friend Parker Stern was known as Parky the Kid. And he is mortified because a Stern lawyer doesn't have the history of being Parky in movies. But it turns out Parky had been in that film.
Right. In Corrupt Practices, the first novel, one of the secrets that Parker Stern has is that he was a child actor. A child star. He had the world's worst stage mother, and at 15 actually divorced her, went to court, and became an emancipated minor. But he's managed somehow, even in this internet age, to keep it secret. He got out just before the internet hit, and he's been forgotten, hopes he's been forgotten, and Parker, in both books, really is looking for family. He didn't have a very good relationship with his mother. He never knew his father. His mother has told various stories about who his father was, and in fact, one time when Parker asked, she said it was none of his business who her father was.
Yeah.
So he's tried to bury that past and didn't have a very good experience and really just wants to be a lawyer and try cases. And in fact, in Corrupt Practices, his law firm was his family. And throughout both books, Parker is trying to recreate that family through the law. And it's very difficult because there's something artificial about the law and constrained. And the relationships are, you're thrown together in the law and then you separate. So that's what Parker's really struggling with. And you know, as you mentioned, Connie, one reason he did take the case was because he discovered that Lovely Diamond, his ex-girlfriend, was on the other side. And as we learned, that was no coincidence.
And throughout the book, people who are involved with him are being murdered. They are dying left and right. The only one who isn't is his mother, who now is sort of like, a religious fanatic who has started a cult. She has gone there and is living like a queen. And the cult is a little dangerous. I don't know what you were referring to or using as inspiration, but it's quite difficult. Now there is a new judge on the case who never liked Parker Stevens. And only when the truth comes out that he's Parky, the kid whom her sister had adored and whom she suddenly stops being his enemy. And when a judge stops being a lawyer's enemy, you're okay.
Absolutely right. When a judge starts being a lawyer's enemy, there is nothing worse than to be in court, to be talking to a judge who's not listening. Luckily, I haven't had it happen much, but when they start writing or looking at the ceiling, you know that there are problems. And as I've gotten along in my career, more and more of my former friends and law students have become judges. And fortunately, I haven't clashed with anyone, but I thought, what if there was someone on the bench who didn't like me? What would I do? And that's what happens to Parker. It's very common now, after several years in practice, like Parker has experienced, to bump into people, and he finds somebody who's who he's clashed with. But as you said, I'm also, these both Corrupt Practice and Reckless Disregard explore celebrity and the dark side, and Parker's tried to hide his past, but celebrity is also valuable to him, and it turns out that the judge was a Parky Gerald fan. That's who Parker was, and all of a sudden things change. It shows you how perceptions can change just because someone is a celebrity or was a celebrity.
And if you had a relative who was a fan as well as that judge, you're in clover. Now, how did you start deciding to be a writer?
Well, I started writing very young. I wrote short stories and poetry, never really pursued it. And then in my 30s, had a career, a family, and then I stopped. And actually, practicing copyright law both helped and hindered my writing development. It hindered because I represent a lot of very successful writers and directors and also studios, and see a lot of claims where plaintiffs come in and they truly believe they've written the next One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and then It's Forrest Gump and anything that took a while to be published. And they truly believe that they've been ripped off and in fact haven't. They are looking at general ideas that are not ripoffs at all. And after a while, although I thought I had some writing ability, I didn't want to be one of those people who deluded themselves. So I really kind of suppressed it. But then the good side of that was I had a case for the brilliant writer-director, I think, John Sayles, over a great movie, Lone Star. And we ended up winning. But in the course of that, it was in Miami, and I met as an expert witness. I hired as an expert witness the man named Les Standiford, who is a wonderful writer himself and the head of the Florida International University Writers Program, where Dennis Lehane and Richard Blanco have gone. And I shared after we became friends that I wanted to be a writer, and he said, show me something that you have. And I wrote something, and it was very amateurish, but he said, you know, it's pretty good, keep going. And with his encouragement and encouragement of others, I actually completed a novel, and here I am.
But in completing it, did you take time away and just concentrate on that?
No, I have a day job, and so I will get up early in the morning and write, and I'll write at lunch if I don't have a lunch engagement, and I'll go home and write into the night. Fortunately, I can focus, and when there are things around me, I'm able to concentrate and keep typing on the computer. And I thank my mother for giving me this old Underwood typewriter, because I'm a fast typist, which really helps.
Okay, have you thought in terms of making a play out of this? Not a movie, a play. Because, you know, you could have Pony Art up on the screen using that as a reference within the play.
That's very interesting. I have, and everybody looks at it and says, you know, both Corrupt Practices and Reckless Disregard would make good movies. You know, my agent explores that. It's something nice about being the writer is I get to be the client, so I don't have to worry about the business side. But I haven't thought about making it into a play. It's a very intriguing idea. Other people suggested someone could make a video game out of abduction. Video game are the new hot media, and I have a video game in Reckless Disregard.
Do you play video games?
I actually don't play video games much. I represent video game companies, though, so I have some familiarity about how they work and what they do. And what one of the interesting research projects I had for Reckless Disregard was reading books on video game design. That was actually kind of fun and different.
There is a professor here who, I'm just looking up his name, you'll know it, whom they go to interview. And he is such a typical I call it summer stock star, because they're very big within their little world, but not really where it counts.
Yeah, without naming names, that professor was based on a lot of expert witnesses I've seen, mostly on the other side, who might have written a screenplay, one successful screenplay, and then they haven't gotten hired since, and then they write some books on how to write a screenplay, and then they go into academia, and I found that a number of those people, again, I won't name names, are very bitter and really anti-Hollywood in a way they shouldn't, and sometimes they take positions in cases that they shouldn't. So that character, whose name was Nate Ettinger, is based on a conglomeration of those professors that I've met in my practice who are somewhat disgruntled about early success and then no follow-up.
But you've captured within William Bishop the sort of man who is the head of a studio. I mean, they march in and they say, I'm ready, are you? You know, it's there at their pleasure.
In my career, met several of them, and again, Bishop is fictionalized, but there is, there are two things. They are immensely powerful, very often impatient, very often temperamental when they need to be temperamental, and very charming when they need to be charming. There were a number of people who had reputations of being ogres who were some of the most charming people that I've met because you need to be in that position. And they know what they want, and they are really like generals of an army. And I tried to capture that with William Bishop.
And you did. Well, until
thanks.
He is caught. Until he suddenly, what he thought was in the dead letter file is now very much alive, and it hits back on him. And you see a man, as you have written him, who shrinks. He shrinks down and will hit out at his own lawyer and then look at Lovely and sit next to me, dear.
Right. I also have known people who have been in a situation where they were on top and they had career setbacks. Bishop has other issues. Ponyard has accused him of murder. Without giving it away, there are some twists and turns that, and we discover some deep, dark secrets about really all the characters, but certainly also William Bishop. But it's interesting to see powerful people who are brought down and they handle it differently. And I hope that there's kind of at the end also, you know, a little bit of nobility about Bishop and the way he handles it. You know, again, without giving away the plot, I have seen the powerful who've fallen been unrealistic and still think they're powerful, and I've seen them have some nobility and some humility afterwards.
Describe Brenda.
Brenda is Parker's assistant. Parker works as a mediator at something called Judicial Alternative Disputes. They call it the JADS for short, the acronym. And Parker doesn't like mediating. Parker's a fighter, but because he's tongue-tied in court, because of the stage fright, he is not able to fight as well as he did. So he's bored. And then the Ponyard case comes in, and Brenda is seemingly someone who's not very educated, working as a case assistant at JADS, and she supposedly was working for Parker's not bringing in any business, and she's worried about losing her job. So she comes in and begs for work, and he puts her on the Ponyard case, not expecting very much. She wears too much makeup, her skirts are too short, she's extremely shy, she can hardly stand in the room with Parker, but she turns out to be a very valuable resource, and much brighter than Parker thinks. It's one of those, you can't judge a book by her cover,
and
if you will.
I loved the fact that Lovely's son, Brighton,
yes,
is that he loves playing the game.
Right. He's actually a game prodigy. Now, Lovely, I painted in Corrupt Practices, is a genius, and so is her son. And he's obsessed with abduction, and he's one of the people online who's actually ahead of the game, literally, because what happens in Reckless Disregard is it looks like the game is starting to predict life, and at some point Parker Stern feels as if he's in a video game being manipulated, villains jumping out at him everywhere, and we're not sure what's real and what's not.
Have you ever had threats on you?
Unfortunately, I have had threats on me at least on three occasions.
Really?
Yes. There's something in... there's something about show business and about creativity and the desire for celebrity that unfortunately brings out the dark side of some people. And I'd say it's very sad, but these people did threaten my life, so I don't feel that sorry for them. There was one in the early 80s who I think the poor man actually was probably schizophrenic. Again, I won't mention names, who said he was going to report me to the first President Bush because my young associate had sprayed poison gas on him at a deposition. And I got a call, it was in the day of the answering service, I got a call saying, don't come to work, someone's threatened to kill you. And I probably not so wisely went to work anyway, and you know, nothing came of the threat, fortunately. There was a second individual who, actually there was a settlement, I can't go into detail, but a fairly generous settlement, not too much, and ran out of the money, and then started saying that he was ripped off. There was a conspiracy between me and his other lawyer. It was all fantasy, and I got a threat there too, and we actually had to get a restraining order against him. There was a litigant who didn't threaten me, but said that I put the date rape drug in her Diet Coke during a break. Again, I will say for the record, none of it true. It's unfortunate that the kind of work I do sometimes at these levels brings out very troubled people. You know, they really want the celebrity, they want the recognition, they want to be thought of as people who are creative and successful. And I think it says something about our society and how important celebrity is.
Robert, I love the book, and now I know why. Is there a sequel to this one?
I'm working on a sequel now. As I mentioned, it's now called Malicious Intent. I mentioned Parker never knew who his father was. In chapter one, his mother, and as you mentioned, Connie, he hasn't had a very good relationship with his mother. She shows up at his condominium, and something's wrong because she never does that. And she says, "I want you to represent somebody." And he said, "I don't want any part of it." And she says, "Well, he's a fugitive from justice. 40 years ago, he was accused of a radical anti-Vietnam War bombing at a federal building that killed four people." And Parker says, "I don't want any part of it." And his mother says, "Oh, by the way, he's your father."
Yeah.
And so Parker takes the case.
I love it. Will you autograph my book?
Absolutely.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. Go to YouTube. You will see this show in a few weeks. But support your local library, because whatever you do, libraries are our finest democratic institution. What did a library mean to you, Robert, growing up?
Oh, I got all my books from the library. I grew up in Culver City, which is the true Hollywood. It's where the MGM studios were, and my school, my elementary school, was catty corner from a back lot. It's now a condominium, but the Culver City Library was wonderful, and that's where I got the, after watching them on TV, that's where I got the Perry Mason, the Earl Stanley Gardner series, and became a lawyer and later became a writer who writes about lawyers.
So take your child with you. You never know what book will inspire them, and you'll be the parent of a writer. We'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Robert.
Thank you. You're